And you guys gave me your slides?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
No, there's no
oh,
slides.
Oh, I did my presentation earlier.
Oh, it was excellent.
Yeah,
really
thank
nice.
You.
Yeah. So it, you know, it's interesting to reflect on some of what we've heard. And the sort of end of the encounter and this idea that the world is becoming more connected and more anticipatory. And you know, there is so much, and Jesse, I might start with you, there's so much infrastructure built up around the idea that medicine happens at a visit, treatment happens
sure.
at a visit, whether it's in an office or in a hospital and whatever. And we were chatting in the hallway, you know, even the American Medical Association has built some of this infrastructure. The CPT is built around procedural, and it's a business of yours. You know, we treat doctors as individual members of the AMA, and that's a business of yours. What has to change to get to the world Jorge just described?
Well, I think we need to get to a point where we can move beyond technology today, where it's a burden, frankly, to the practice of medicine and becomes an asset. And the challenge is that there's this huge opportunity to expand access to care through things like telemedicine, but we need opportunities to see technology that's evidence-based, that's validated, and actually can integrate in workflows in ways that, frankly, there's been a huge disconnect today. And the AMA has been trying to figure out how we can build sort of a powerful network to drive technology development that flips that around, that suddenly can put the physician perspective and patients at the center of the I see hundreds of real hammers for the proverbial nail, and that is a problem that we need to solve.
Got it. So, Rena, you're trying to solve it.
Yeah.
How's it going?
Great. Great. You know, one of the things that poked me for a while when I was a practicing physician, it gets to what you were just talking about, Jesse. I mean, I feel like the physician encounter has increasingly become not an encounter with the patient, but an encounter with technology, which is not why I got into healthcare. I mean, I love people, I love being with people, I love making people better, right? And so the itch for me when I left my faculty job in academia was to see if we couldn't balance the power of technology, but with the humanity of a provider. To find that combination, the right aliquots, the right combinations of people and tech, that was the right balance. You know, for me as a clinician to deliver care, but for patients to really feel that they were balanced with one another.
And part of that's putting the patient back in the center. There was a Dartmouth-Hitchcock AMA study in 3 years ago that found that for every hour that physicians are in front of patients, they spend 2 hours doing administrative work and dealing with the electronic health record. That is not the situation that we ought to be in. Mm-hmm. We'd like to get technology out of the way that can enable us to do what we frankly really enjoy, which is taking care of patients and committing our lives to keeping people healthy. Yeah.
Can we retitle this, like, Bash the EMR? Is that the topic of this conversation?
That's cocktail hour.
I'm totally happy to, like, have the whole half hour be about that.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because I'm going to push you both a little bit on this, which is we often talk about if we get the right technology and we're surrounded around the physician and we put the patient at the center, that's a good thing. It's still built around this kind of reactive model where somebody shows up and then I have connective tentacles around that that do good things. But Chris this morning told us 90% of his visits can be done virtually in his new clinic. We may have a place where what I want to do is pay a physician to monitor somebody and see some patients once a week and some mm-hmm. patients they might never meet face to face. That's a fundamental change in the profession.
Yeah.
What has to change, Rena, maybe with you, what have you had to train physicians to do differently, to practice differently?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a great point, right? Like we treat patients within these minuscule interactions that happen once every 6 months or once every year. And we expect everything to happen within these little tiny encounters, right?
Yeah.
But really what you want is a relationship. And that relationship, the encounters can be of varying types and of duration and of frequency based on the patient's need. I mean, how are we training physicians to do this better? I mean, you gotta be able to interact with your patient outside of that encounter, but the reality is the system is still incentivized for that encounter to drive payment and therefore maintain, you know, the system will maintain as such without a change in that kind of perverse incentive structure.
You know, we did a survey of physicians in 2016, our physician digital health survey. It's free on our website if you want to take a look at it. And we found a couple of things. One is there's a lot less digital divide than we expected.
Okay.
You know, most physicians are using a couple of digital tools in their practices, large, small, and age, frankly, was not a big divider. There's a lot of assumption that older docs just, you know, are Luddites and don't want to embrace technology. Not the case based on our data. But physicians want tools that work, and they want tools that will actually improve their practice, integrate into the workflow, and make their lives easier. Today, we're just not seeing those tools brought to the marketplace in a rational way.
Yeah. So on the payment point, maybe Jesse, we'll start with you. You know, sometimes you say, well, right now I get paid for encounters. The kind of, you know, simple solution to that, well, I'll put you at risk, just do the right thing. Is it fair to put physicians at risk?
Well, we're certainly seeing that happen more and more as there are increased value-based payment sort of contracting happening in the marketplace. The AMA has put together a group of experts through our Digital Medicine Payment Advisory Group that's been thinking about, you know, what sort of has to shift when it comes to coding reimbursement to enable things like telehealth. And we've had some real progress in terms of what's happening and with payers nationally. There's a lot that will, I think, evolve in the next few years as we see more and more of these tools come together.
Yeah, but digging on that a little bit more, if I said, because part of what I'm reflecting on is when I spend time with physicians, if I said to the average physician, I'll tell you what, do whatever you think your patients need, just make them healthier and get their total cost of care down, here you go. Most of them don't know what to do. Is that a fair bargain?
I think that's fair, and I think there are certain places where we're seeing real growth and savings and improved outcomes. Those are the kinds of things that ultimately we should be incentivizing, again, in a tech-enabled world.
Yeah.
I mean, it's totally not fair.
Yeah.
Unless you give them the tools to be able to do it properly,
yeah.
right? And which you're getting at, Jesse, and you're hinting at, right?
Yeah.
I mean, as a single doc, you don't have the resources on changing, but I would say it's great in theory, but until you give physicians the practical tools to be able to do it. And docs want to do it. And docs want our patients to be better.
Yeah.
We don't want to have to sit for 15 minutes and, you know, check all the boxes on review of systems to make sure we can bill at a level 4 or level 5 instead of a level 2 or level 3. We would love that, but we're not really unable to do that.
Yeah. So when we give people tools, and Rena, you've said this to me before, we've lost credibility because of the EMR. We showed up and we said, we're here from administration, we're here to help. Now here's an EMR.
Help,
It doesn't feel like a whole heck of a lot of help. in fact, it felt like a Trojan horse. And now we show up and say, no, I got two tools, but don't worry, these are good ones.
Mm-hmm.
How do we undo the damage?
I think a lot of trust was lost with EMR implementation. I'll start and feel free to. Easier to code, it's easier to check boxes, and that data helps support in 99. 214, et cetera, right? Probably got the CPT code wrong. But, you know, and yes, there's some good things in it, med reconciliation, making sure there's no drug-drug interactions. There was good baked into it that was helpful. But it really wasn't meant for physicians. And it actually, to some degree, wasn't really meant for patients either. So I think there was some trust building to do.
And unfortunately, I think we suffered from, frankly, bad federal policy that misaligned incentives with the technology that wasn't at a place where it could do the things that it was promised to do. And now there are things that are starting to be brought forward through HHS and CMS to fix some of that around interoperability and data liquidity and sharing things. We have some concerns about how that's being done. You know, the EHR certainly is a cautionary tale about tools that aren't optimized for the intended purpose. We worry a lot about what's happening in the AI space, what's happening with a disconnect between developers throwing technologies at problems that are likely to be unhelpful. And we have put a lot of thought and effort into bringing experts together to develop our policy positions around what augmented intelligence should look like, making sure that it's usable, explainable, is reproducible, and actually leads to better outcomes. But unfortunately, when you look at what's being brought into the marketplace, that's often just frankly not the case.
Yeah,
so I think there's this perception that physicians aren't willing to engage with innovative solutions, or that we physicians are the barrier, which is not true. Like, I think in the end, if you brought me a great solution that helped my patient get better and generated a better outcome and kept them out of the hospital, great. But bring me a good solution and make it easy for me to implement it, make it functional. I don't want all your steps. I don't want your step count. I don't want like every single reading. I want actionable information that I can then use to create insights that can help me help the patient improve their health.
Yeah, and look, I I meet hundreds of doctors all across the country every year as I do, you know, work on behalf of the association in spreading, you know, the work of the AMA. I just don't meet physicians who aren't motivated by all else trying to help patients. Yeah. People want to do the right thing. They just often feel like their hands are tied and they don't have the tools.
Horst ran a medical school, which is kind of a fun thought experiment to do. I suspect you'd be taught to be available 24/7, and you'd be taught to make time for people whenever they need it, and you'd probably spend a lot of time going to people's homes. And that's not the model in which most physicians practice. In fact, getting them to extend hours or be open on a Saturday or get in a car and go see somebody is a struggle. First, I'd be curious, do you believe in Ian Horst's vision of kind of service excellence and that's where healthcare should go? And then secondly, if that's where it goes, how do we get people who think of themselves sometimes as professionals rather than as in a service industry to change their mindset?
Yeah. I think you'd actually be surprised at the number of organizations, large and small, that actually have bought into that philosophy. And the AMA has a set of tools that we make available to actually anybody free on our website through our Steps Forward initiative to try to help practices and organizations think through those kinds of initial steps. Certainly, I've had the experience of sort of trying to think about system transformation that's aligned with those kinds of ideas in my non-AMA roles in the provider systems that I've worked in.
Yeah, I think we do it. There probably are physicians that don't do it. I know they don't. I know there are. But I think there are a lot of good docs who believe in those principles, right? Staying late at night, putting the EMR aside to sit with the patient and hold a hand. That happens. It still happens. And it's glorious when it happens. Yeah. Are there reasons why it doesn't happen as often now? Yes. And so how do we get back to that core? I mean, I went, both my parents are physicians. And I have such great memory of accompanying my father to a home visit. I mean, he picked me up from school, he had to go see a patient, right? And I'm like, oh, really, Dad? We gotta.
And that's where you learned to code and bill?
Yes, okay. Exactly. I was next to him scribing. And my
friend. Yeah.
But just, I have such a distinct memory. And the patient and their family were so grateful. Just this, what he talked about this morning, I sort of saw that in this like microcosm of this encounter that my father had with his patient who couldn't come see him, so he went to see her.
I mean, I will tell you, I remember at some point in my training, I'm an anesthesiologist, that's kind of my day job, I still take care of patients, I love being in the operating room, and I remember someone very pointedly telling me, you know, it's great that you go in, you see the patient, meet them pre-op, you've got to end every visit, every encounter, every time you're interacting with a patient or family by saying, is there anything else I can do for you? And I will tell you, most of the times people say no, but I think we heard this morning that when you make that small request of somebody, it signals to them something that goes beyond just this transactional experience that often happens.
That service concept we have to think about for how we interact with one another, too. Administrators and physicians, I mean, there's a physician-patient relationship, right, for which it's core. But I do think how we treat and interact with one another, that sometimes gets forgotten too.
So what has to change?
It's this mindset, right, of how can I help you as opposed to you need to do X. Because that's, as you mentioned about trust, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of this between physician organizations and administration. I come from an academic medical center, so I remember that. But I think there needs to be more partnership and more how can I serve you and how can we serve one another and how do we do this together? Because in the end, it's a patient that we're looking to serve.
Yeah. Jesse, you look like you got something.
Well, I think those interactions are very different depending on the patient. And you know, I've got plenty of patients who just it's very old school. Doc, what do I need to do? I have other patients who are very engaged in decision making. And there's a whole spectrum, right? And that has to drive what those experiences look like. And that becomes difficult, I think, when you think about technology and technology platforms that different kinds of patients want to interact with quite differently. One thing that concerns me deeply is I think about health equity and the work that the AMA is engaged in. We just spun up a new Center for Health Equity and have a new vice president who's leading that work across the country. Is with the increasing digital divide, we've got great tools that are wonderful that often I think are continuing to leave people behind in a way that's unfortunate.
So a little bit orthogonal to that, who should own the relationship in the future? Rena, I sit here and I listen to the conversations and you know, your patients are able to patients. Mm-hmm. They're not patients of Dr. So-and-so. You know, Jesse, you've, as an anesthesiologist, probably been comfortable with that kind of patients or whoever else. Who owns that in the future?
Not sure what that looks like. I will tell you that one thing that we struggle with is the fragmentation that's happening today. You know, I will tell you personally, I saw 3 different primary care doctors in 3 different systems in the last 6 weeks, right? And so none of that information is flowing anywhere. Who owns me? What's going on? You know, it's a bit of a mess, Tower of Babel. There should be solutions to help with that, which is why the AMA is very concerned about issues like data liquidity, interoperability, which are foundational to solving some of those problems. You know, who owns that in the end? Not sure, but it's got to be better than where we are today.
Yeah. Who owns Able2's patients?
Good question. I think the answer would differ based on where you sit.
Yeah.
So I think of them as Able2 patients. I think the patients, they connect to their provider. So within the Able2 network, you know, the patient has a therapist and the patient has a coach. Those are the people they think of as their clinicians. I don't think they think of Able2 as a clinician. It's an interesting question. I mean, I think in the end, I don't know if this is a great answer, but the patient isn't really the owner of the patient, right? And we've made the doctor center of the model. The reality is sometimes you need a doc, sometimes you need a therapist, sometimes just, you know, as a the first step into the system. Sometimes you need a nutritionist, or there are a host of people that can be involved, but in the end, you know, it's the patient. Now, the flip of that is, I do think we've moved the needle sometimes a little too far to patient is self, best self-advocate. Patient can make their own decisions, and as you described, there are times when the patient wants that, and there are times when the patient really needs us to come together to help support them to make a decision with them.
Yeah.
I think the level of acuity makes a big difference, right? So, you know, I'm a pretty healthy guy. I don't need a lot of healthcare. I don't use a lot of healthcare. I'm happy to drive a lot of that conversation. But I will tell you, God forbid I have a diagnosis of cancer. I want to walk into somebody who's empathic and can help me and be a guide in driving sort of what I need to happen. And I see that because I take care of patients who have that sort of range of acuity. And I think that gets lost in the conversation.
Yeah. Well, we both had kids who've, you know, been in the ICU.
Sure.
We were talking about this before we came on. We both had babies in the NICU, and our mine's now 16 years, is only 4 months, so I'm a long way away from it.
You can see the circles under my eyes with the former.
I have circles for different reasons, like college applications. But I do, in that moment, I remember it well. I did not want to make decisions. Yeah. Like I needed someone to hold my hand, make sure I was okay, and help me figure out what needed to happen. If they'd asked me, what do you want here? Do you want a CPAP, or do you want your child intubated? Like, please just save my baby, right? Mm-hmm. That's all I want.
It'd be interesting to see how that evolves. You know, it's going back to the horse story over and over again. I think he created a place where the loyalty was to the Ritz-Carlton, and the people who worked there were individual points of light. But the idea would be, I'm a Ritz-Carlton loyalist, and then if somebody does a great job for me, I, you know, wrote it on one of his 400,000 comment cards. Mm-hmm. We built healthcare almost in the opposite direction, where the loyalty is to the person, and we've kind of surrounded them with, you know, what at worst is overhead and at best is enabling technology. And it'll be interesting to see that evolve. And I think, you know, part of how that evolves is physicians wanting something different out of the job. And, you know, we all know the stats about physicians becoming more diverse and how the population's changing. And Jesse, you know, one thing in particular that struck me is 2 years ago, for the first time in American history, we had more women in med school than men. How's your membership changing, and how does that change expectations?
So the membership of the AMA is changing dramatically, consistent with the population demographics. It's really interesting. This year, we have a president of the AMA who's the first African-American female elected president, and the past president, president-elect of the AMA are all women. I'm the first openly LGBTQ chair of the AMA board. And certainly part of the answer is that we need more women, more people of color represented in leadership as we sort of think about how do these solutions represent sort of the people that we serve. You know, we know that African Americans actually have better health outcomes when they're cared for by African American physicians.
And, you know, Rena, building on that, sometimes when we try to make change happen, big or small, in organizations across the country and around the world, at first you get resistance from physician leadership. Mm-hmm. And then as you start to dig in, actually, 80% of physicians would be very happy to move along, and that leadership literally doesn't look like the people they represent, and doesn't have the point of view of the people they represent. And you've had to partner with organizations across the country. How do we break through that? I mean, in most places, physician leadership does not look like the two of you, and it doesn't look like the people who are practicing most of the medicine. How do you bridge the divide in making change happen?
Yeah, I mean, first is to do what you guys are doing, which is to put people in positions of power that look more like the diversity of the physicians around the United States, right? I mean, kudos, right? It's very uncommon. Around the payers around the country, increasingly, we're seeing similar kinds of diversity amongst physician leaders. Thinking about Cheryl Pegus at Cambia and others, right, where we're now seeing more people who look like the diversity of physicians across the country. But short of that, you have to find ways to connect. Yeah. And we heard about last night in Jill's talk with Terry about this point about affinity. And I think even though we look different, there are points of connection. And it is on us to find those points of connection and find ways to communicate and interact with one another so that we can make change even if we don't look alike.
Yeah. Jesse, you got a thought?
No, I think it's critical. And again, we are at an interesting place in our nation's history as we think about a lot of these issues around race and inclusion and what that means. And I am the ever optimist. Mm-hmm. I think we have an incredibly resilient country. And I think that physicians and the healthcare workforce have an important place to play as we think about how our society moves forward in a positive direction.
So as we close here, you've got a room full of healthcare executives, some of whom are physicians, most of whom are not, but all of whom deal with physicians on a regular basis. They're trying to build for impact. They're trying to build organizations that change people's lives in the ways we've heard about all day. Rena, I'll start with you.
Okay.
One piece of advice for them about how to go back and deal with their physicians?
Well, you've already set up the negative, right? Go how to deal with your physicians. I guess that would be my comment.
Well, don't think that way.
Don't think that way, right? Think of physicians, clinicians more broadly than physicians even. First step, right? There's, we're two docs and representing, Jesse's representing the MA, but it's a broader clinician set than physicians alone that are necessary to really make it a system for patients. So I would say think broadly as clinicians, not physicians. And then number two, it's a different, go at it with a different perception.
Yeah.
It's not about how do we deal with our physicians. It's how do we partner with our physicians to create an environment and an ecosystem that's better for patients.
And I would just say, again, physicians are motivated to take care of patients and support health. And we just struggle sometimes to figure out, as the world is changing, how our roles need to evolve and change. And I think we're certainly seeing that happen. You know, I can guarantee that the practice of radiology with, AI digital tools is going to look very different in 10 years than it does today. We're already starting to see signals of that. That's not a problem. I think physicians embrace that. I think that there are ways to support that transition, and again, keeping the physician at the center of the conversation.
Dr. Jesse.